Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ending Epidemics, A History of Escape from Contagion, by Richard Conniff, narrated by Tom Beyer. Preface: The Healing. In our hearts, none of us believed the pandemic would come next year, or even within our lifetimes. We may have wallowed in the eye-bleeding horrors of The Hot Zone or the rampant infectiousness of the movie Contagion, but it was voyeuristic. We were thrilled and yet managed to keep these viral horrors separate from our own lives. The turning point for me came just after midnight one day in my first month of COVID-19 lockdown, on reading a news report of deaths in a pandemic hotspot. "Some crematories in New York City are incinerating bodies at 4 times the normal rate," it said. "Hospitals have run out of body bags or turned to forklifts to transfer piles of corpses into makeshift mobile morgues." This wasn't London in a plague year, it was now, in neighborhoods that I knew. And it suddenly seemed strange that we could ever have felt safe, or would ever do so again. Why was it so shocking? Where had we come by the implausible sense of our safety? It's based on how those of us born since World War II have spent our lives, without quite recognizing just how fortunate we have been. This is mainly true in the developed world, but low-income nations have also shared in the benefits, especially in this century. Thanks to modern medical discoveries, a swarm of diseases that were once our ancestors' familiar lot have faded away, in many cases within living memory. That's the subject of this book. It's the story of humanity's long and, until now, extraordinarily successful struggle against infectious diseases. If this were another time in our history, we would be accustomed to sickness and death from diseases including malaria, diphtheria, yellow fever, scarlet fever, plague, polio, cholera, tetanus, tuberculosis, typhus, typhoid fever, and smallpox. Quaint-seeming terms like blood poisoning from causes as trivial as a splinter or lockjaw from a rusty nail would still be on every mother's tongue. We would expect children to spend long weeks laid up with whooping cough, mumps, chickenpox, and measles. One child in 3 would die before reaching school age. Depending on how old you are, you can count off these diseases according to how close an escape you have made. Polio, for instance, caused permanent paralysis in 21,300 Americans and killed 3,150 in 1952, shortly before the Salk vaccine arrived. Measles was infecting more than 530,000 American children in an average year and killing 440 before the arrival of a vaccine in 1963. And in 1974, on the brink of eradication, smallpox still infected 218,000 people worldwide and killed about a third of them. I can count off this history of escape from infectious disease in my own family, and it's a measure of how recent, dramatic, and personal this change has been. Growing up in the Bronx in the 1920s, my uncle had polio, and it left him on crutches for life. But polio season became summer again for me after my grade school class reluctantly lined up in 1956 to receive Jonas Salk's new polio vaccine. I came down with measles, on the other hand, in the pre-vaccine peak epidemic of 1958 and was laid out for a week, with voices whispering outside my bedroom door, and the curtains drawn tight to block out the sun. In the United States, measles killed 552 children that year. I also had most of the other childhood diseases, as did my classmates. My children had just one, chickenpox, for which a vaccine became available only in 1995. To say this happened in living memory may, however, overstate the case. It is the catch-22 of vaccines, and in truth, of all infectious disease discoveries. They save us from diseases, then cause us to forget the diseases from which they have saved us. You get a sense of how clueless we were about epidemics before COVID-19 by the casual way we used the word, with our anxious talk about the obesity epidemic, the autism epidemic, even the tanning epidemic, and of course, the epidemic of anxiety. Once a disease like measles appears to be gone from our lives, we become lax, or worse. Well-meaning parents increasingly avoid vaccinating their children, particularly when it comes to the measles, mumps, rubella, MMR vaccine. As a result, a major measles outbreak in 2019 sickened children in Europe, the United States, and other areas that vaccination had once made measles-free. Parents had forgotten that children with measles can die or suffer permanent intellectual disability. They forgot that an outbreak of rubella in the 1960s resulted in 20,000 American children being born with brain damage, including autism and other abnormalities. Much as our forebears were fatalistically accepting of epidemic diseases, we had become naively oblivious to them. Even the HIV/AIDS epidemic did not change this overall picture, despite the suffering and death it continues to cause. When antiretroviral therapy became available in the 1990s, people who tested positive accepted it and found they could lead normal lives again. Worldwide life expectancy, having more than doubled in the 20th century, continued to edge upward. Until COVID-19. The Struggle to Remember. This book started out as a conscious effort to remember. One day, I was checking my yellow international immunization card, which I keep with my passport, and found myself puzzling over the entry for Tdap. I recognized the T for tetanus and the P for pertussis, or whooping cough, but I was ignorant about the D. Even pediatricians now tend to know diphtheria only from textbooks. But before the development of serum therapy in the 1890s and effective vaccines in the 20th century, diphtheria was among the great terrors of childhood. It killed more than 3,000 young Americans one year in the mid-1930s, when my parents were in high school. It is once again killing children today, in Venezuela, Yemen, and other areas where political upheaval has disrupted the delivery of vaccine. Among other symptoms, diphtheria clots a child's throat with a gray membrane of dead cells, which can cause death by strangulation. In past epidemics, it was sufficiently contagious to take down whole families of children, whole streets of them, leaving only the shattered parents behind in the sudden quiet. I write about it in Chapter 22. From diphtheria, I soon found myself digging back into the story of the people who came to understand such terrible diseases and consign them to history. My interest is specifically in how researchers found ways to save us from some of the deadliest infectious diseases, and how their stories can help us continue to escape such diseases well into the future. Past accounts of medical discovery tended to hagiography, perhaps because the grateful writers still had personal experience of the diseases being overcome. Winston Churchill, who saw a friend die of typhoid in South Africa, and whose father is said to have died from tertiary syphilis, once wrote that the beatific choir should make room for Saint Anesthesia, Saint Antiseptic, and Saint Penicillin, each with a suitable feast day. He wasn't entirely joking. Today, though, that note of veneration feels misplaced. Maybe that's another symptom of our having forgotten the diseases medical discoverers cured or prevented. But we have also come to recognize that heroes too often turn out on closer examination to be problematic. As a group, until the mid-20th century, medical discoverers were almost exclusively white and male. They frequently came from families that were relatively wealthy or of the right social class. Most lived in nations subsidized by empire, able to extract wealth, knowledge, and products from colonized countries, and with a financial system capable of supporting education and scientific research. They accomplished great things, but like athletes caught using performance-enhancing drugs, it can seem as if they should go into the history books with an asterisk. Marginalized groups were often vehemently denied any credit, even when their contribution to a medical advance was public knowledge. During a 1721 smallpox epidemic in Boston, for instance, African-born residents of the city revealed a method to prevent this deadly disease. It worked, but their role was minimized and ridiculed from the start. And when a woman introduced the same method in England based on first-hand experience in Turkey, her recompense included a heaping bowlful of misogynist bile. I write about these cases in Chapter 6. As I worked on this book, I tried, where possible, to position individuals we think of as lone geniuses within the network of people on whom they depended. Louis Pasteur, for instance, was always known to be an ambitious and enthusiastic self-promoter, but he depended on largely unacknowledged contributions by physician Émile Roux, among others. I write about them in chapters 17 and 21. It's possible to say this while still recognizing Pasteur as a master of experimental science and brilliant at choosing the right path from one experiment to the next. Likewise, Joseph Lister, who introduced antiseptics to the operating room, depended throughout his career on research performed in their home laboratory by Agnes Syme, his wife. And yet, Lister excluded her from any credit for their work. I write about them in Chapter 15. Jonas Salk acknowledged that his polio vaccine benefited from a key contribution by John Enders, but he overlooked Isabel Morgan, who developed a crucial forerunner of the vaccine. Legend to the contrary, no great medical discovery was ever the unaided work of a lone genius or wholly original. New ideas don't just appear out of nowhere and instantly change everything. Instead, they rise up over and over like waves and mostly beat themselves out against the sand unnoticed. It takes special circumstances, lucky timing, the subtle influence of previous waves before an idea gathers strength and becomes a tsunami. Beta versions of a discovery may appear repeatedly before taking hold. The work we end up labeling genius was rarely just a matter of making a discovery. It was also about making the discovery known well enough to break through the wall of tradition-bound indifference. It was about building a case to make the discovery believed beyond reasonable doubt. Nor has any great discovery ever resulted from the special blessing of the gods. Everything resulted first from favorable circumstances and then from long preparation, followed by endlessly patient watching and thinking about the problem at hand, with a certain amount of discreet eavesdropping on what others were doing and thinking, followed by experimentation, repeated over and over with small variations, frequent failures, no guarantee of eventual success, and frustration leading at times to the brink of madness. The idea that great scientists come with abundant flaws and that medical discovery has always depended on collaboration may at first seem less inspiring. But I have found medical discoverers much easier to understand as leading figures in a network of collaborators than as heroic demigods. Their quirks and missteps remind us that people with ordinary failings can nonetheless achieve great and heroic things together. Knowing how they struggled with familiar human issues and with one another ought to make it easier for rising scientists, particularly those feeling marginalized by gender, race, or sexual orientation, to set aside imposter syndrome and walk more confidently in their own footsteps. Among other characteristics, it seemed to me as I was working on this book that past medical discoverers were often adept not just at synthesizing existing lines of research, but also at imagining how to push them forward in surprising ways. They consistently displayed an urge to see things with their own eyes, rather than rely on what they learned in classrooms or textbooks. During an 1835 autopsy, for instance, medical student and amateur botanist James Paget looked more closely at gritty specks in muscle, which his instructors described as bits of bone. With the help of a microscope, Paget discovered that they were in fact cysts containing parasitic worms. "I believe," he explained, "that I alone looked at them and observed them. No one trained in natural history could have failed to do so." Paying close attention to the complex lives of plants and animals was good training for observing the symptoms of patients and the behaviors of microbes. It struck me, as I did my research, that the study of the diseases of humans and other animals is itself a branch of natural history. It's a story of coming to understand the human body as a habitat, and many human diseases as a colonization of that habitat. Diseases also have their own evolutionary history, appearing or disappearing, becoming more virulent or less so, jumping from one species to another, with baffled humans struggling to figure it all out before it kills us. Medical discovery itself is not linear, one great idea emerging from another in a neat progression. It's more like evolution, branchy, confused, with lots of false starts and dead ends. We don't conquer disease, the trope of past medical histories. More often, medical discoveries enable us to fend off diseases for a time as they emerge, evolve, and then reemerge. In what follows, I have attempted to weave together all the threads of discovery, into a single story of the struggle against disease across three centuries. It starts with the first description of bacteria on April 24, 1676, and ends with the eradication of smallpox and the last known death from it on September 11, 1978. Listeners will object that HIV/AIDS, Ebola, COVID-19, and other emerging diseases have taught us too well that the story does not end there. But the eradication of smallpox was a turning point in human history and remains a powerful model for what humans can still achieve when we set aside differences and work together against disease. In between these two events, I focus on a series of key developments that persuaded the medical world to stop seeking the causes of epidemic disease in noxious miasmas, bodily humors, or divine dyspepsia. Instead, they learned to focus on pathogens, and also on dramatic improvements in sanitation, control of disease-carrying arthropods, the proliferation of antiseptics, the discovery of antibiotics and other antimicrobials, and the development of new vaccines and technologies. If I sometimes dwell on the dreadful symptoms of past diseases, that's deliberate. A reminder of just how much we owe the researchers who enabled us to escape these symptoms. It's also a reminder of how important it is to muster public will for the inconvenient work of preventing or controlling these diseases. As you listen, it will help to set aside present knowledge. Forget what you know about bacteria, say, or mosquitoes, and instead try stepping back into the minds of our forebears. Imagine a time when all anyone really understood about infectious disease was death, often coming in a terrifying rush of symptoms that either drove away the victim's loved ones or kept them close to become victims themselves. Then imagine what it took to make sense of these unknown and unimaginable forces and somehow stop them. Putting ourselves in the minds of our predecessors and in the face of such diseases is a way to appreciate how hard it was to achieve the sense of safety we take for granted. It may also turn out to be useful practice for other pandemics still to come. 1. What the Draper Saw. The life of one 17th century Dutch merchant was more fortunate than most. Antony van Leeuwenhoek, 1632 to 1723, lived to be 90, seemingly unscathed by infectious disease, but he saw death all around him. He lost two infant siblings while still a child, then his father when he was just 5, and his stepfather when he was 15. Later, he lost 4 of his 5 children by his first wife, who died when she was just 36. His second wife survived 23 years of marriage and produced 1 child, who also died. Leeuwenhoek was not, however, driven by a compulsion to understand why this should be so. He was a draper, a cloth merchant, knowledgeable in matters of button loops and bombazine, not human physiology. And yet his work, or rather what he did in the hours before and after work, would begin the unraveling of the dark secrets of infectious disease. Leeuwenhoek was born into a family of basket makers and brewers in a spacious 3-story canal house in Delft, a coastal city of more than 20,000 people. Delft merchants were among the founding partners in the Dutch East India Company, the world's first transnational corporation. The wealth it produced in the colonial trade for spices, sugar, and other commodities translated into opportunity at home, much as poverty elsewhere sent genius packing off unnoticed to an early grave. It's a measure of Delft's prosperity in the Dutch Golden Age that Leeuwenhoek's christening was entered into the baptismal registry of the city's Nieuwe Kerk on the same page as another newborn of 1632 named Johannes Vermeer, and each lived to fulfill his native genius. In 1654, after a six-year internship with an Amsterdam merchant, Leeuwenhoek returned to Delft to establish his own fabric business. He married, purchased a home around the corner from the central market square, and began to play a part in civic affairs. To science, though, he was merely an ordinary shopkeeper holding a few minor municipal appointments, in the words of one biographer. Nor was he physically memorable. Contemporary portraits depict him in sumptuous robes and a periwig, but they also capture the shallow eyes set slightly wide in a round face above a substantial nose and an abbreviated pencil mustache. A new visible world. People tend now to remember Leeuwenhoek as the inventor of the microscope. But that essential discovery in the history of medicine emerged in the late 1500s, a lifetime before his birth. His fascination with microscopes dates only from the 1660s, and it was a book that awakened him to the discoveries being made possible by magnification. By the means of telescopes, there is nothing so far distant but may be represented to our view. And by the help of microscopes, there is nothing so small as to escape our inquiry, British polymath Robert Hooke wrote in Micrographia, published in 1665. Hence there is a new visible world discovered to the understanding, and in every little particle of its matter, we now behold almost as great a variety of creatures as we were able before to reckon up in the whole universe itself. Micrographia was the first true scientific picture book, with finely detailed illustrations in the author's own hand. London diarist Samuel Pepys bought an early copy that January, and he sat up until 2 o'clock a.m. on a Saturday night with what he pronounced the most ingenious book that ever I read in my life. Hooke depicted a gargantuan flea in extreme close-up on a gatefold page wider than the book itself, so the flea seemed to leap cat-like into the reader's lap. He made a small white spot of hairy mold found on the leather cover of a book look like a flower garden on spindly stalks. These microscopical mushrooms were actually the reproductive structures of a small fungus belonging to the genus Mucor. It was the first description by any human observer of a microbial life form. Micrographia may initially have caught Leeuwenhoek's eye as a fabric merchant, an occupation that relied on the equivalent of a jeweler's loop to make thread counts. The book's illustrations included a piece of fine linen, magnified to look like coarse matting, as Hooke put it, and a bit of taffeta silk ribbon seeming like a very convenient substance to make doormats. But Hooke urged readers to proceed further and to attempt greater things in the same and different ways. Leeuwenhoek took heed, moving beyond fabrics into the biological world, where he would travel widely over the rest of his life. Hooke preferred to work with a conventional compound microscope, a tube with lenses at each end mounted on a stand, which he said was easier on the weakness of his eyes. But he also described a technique that seems to have become the basis for Leeuwenhoek's very different single-lens microscopes. It involved heating a very clear piece of a broken Venice glass with a candle, drawing the glass out into threads, and then heating these threads in the flame till a small globule formed on the end. After the maker ground off the rough parts of this globule and polished it with triple-E buffing compound, it could be mounted as a pinhole lens in what looked like a handheld magnifying glass, usually about 3 or 4 inches long. To examine a specimen, Leeuwenhoek generally glued it to a pin or sometimes placed it on a glass plate mounted in front of the lens. One screw, which doubled as a handle, allowed him to move the specimen up or down. Another screw moved it in or out. He could thus position the specimen in front of the lens for a precise focus as he held the instrument up to his eye. In the spring of 1673, 8 years after the publication of Micrographia, a letter arrived at the Royal Society in London from a Delft physician who was a fellow of the Society. "I am writing to tell you," he began, "that a certain most ingenious person named Leeuwenhoek has devised microscopes which far surpass those which we have hitherto seen." He enclosed a letter in which Leeuwenhoek described some of his first rudimentary findings. The physician urged the Society to test the skill of this most diligent man by proposing to him more difficult problems of the same kind. With this introduction, Leeuwenhoek began a lifelong correspondence with the Royal Society, where Robert Hooke himself was then curator of experiments. He had moved on from microbes to roam brilliantly across the scientific universe. Leeuwenhoek, by contrast, stuck with a shopkeeper's patience to his microscopes. The skill and curiosity with which he explored the microbial world over the next half century would transform the human body and the planet itself from the intimately familiar to something astonishingly strange and populous. An abundance of little animals. Almost from the start, Leeuwenhoek saw things no one ever had. He was apparently blessed with excellent vision, and he was able to grind his lenses more finely than others could, enabling him to magnify his specimens by as much as 300 times their actual size and resolve objects almost down to a micron. He worked in a room with a northeastern exposure lit by a bank of leaded glass casement windows, of the sort familiar from numerous Vermeer paintings. Like Vermeer, Leeuwenhoek made himself a master of finding the best light for any given subject by flinging open the shutters or drawing them tight, adjusting the curtains, working by candlelight, or other means he chose to keep secret. He was also a skilled craftsman at the precise metalwork needed to position and hold each lens, producing more than 500 different magnifying devices over the course of his career, each suited to a different subject. His workroom was equipped with small smelting furnaces, metalworking machinery, a glass-blowing table, lens-grinding materials, and other equipment. Then there were the specimens. Von Leeuwenhoek made thin slices of optical nerves, brains, hair, tongue, spleen, muscle, eye, tendon, bone marrow, skin, and fat, as well as all kinds of botanical materials, Leslie A. Robertson and her co-authors write in Antony von Leeuwenhoek, Master of the Minuscule. He boiled brains to make them easier to handle or reveal structures more clearly. Sometimes he found it necessary to wash away soft tissue or let it rot away. Leeuwenhoek reported his observations in letters to the Royal Society. Henry Oldenburg, a German immigrant who was then secretary there, translated them into English, edited them, and deemed them remarkable enough to publish in issue after issue of the Society's Philosophical Transactions. What Leeuwenhoek was seeing bordered on the fantastical. A sample of water from a nearby lake contained an abundance of little animals, some of which were roundish, he wrote, others oval, some whitish, others pellucid, still others with green and very shining little scales. A few of these creatures were plodding, but the motion of most of them in the water was so swift, Leeuwenhoek wrote, and so various, upwards, downwards, and round about, that I confess I could not but wonder at it. Leeuwenhoek was peering for the first time into the unsuspected world of microorganisms that behaved like animals. He was describing protozoa, a group of single-celled microorganisms that includes both free-living and parasitic species. Leeuwenhoek sometimes called the microscopic creatures he was describing little eels or worms, sometimes exceedingly small insects or animals, and sometimes just animalcules, a Latin diminutive. It would be another 60 years before Carolus Linnaeus would devise the system of naming living things by genus and species. Along with non-existent nomenclature, Leeuwenhoek lacked anything remotely like standard units of measurement at the microscopic scale. He made do with homely comparisons. One sort of little animals was 1,000 times smaller than the eye of a louse. Another was as small relative to a cheese mite as a bee is to a horse. Leeuwenhoek intended none of these comparisons casually. He took the development of a system of measurements as seriously as he did the making of lenses and microscopes. Such comparisons led him to make the eye-widening estimate that a single drop of water could contain 1,000,000 of these minute creatures. Apart from the seemingly outlandish observations, this relatively new correspondent often wrote in a conversational tone, interspersed with opinions and details of his personal life. He sets down his views, frequently quite mistaken and even ridiculous views, with childish and charming simplicity, British microbiologist Clifford Dobell wrote, with obvious affection, in his 1932 biography of Leeuwenhoek. And he has no feeling of embarrassment in telling the Royal Society the most intimate details about his blood, his sweat, or his urine, or about his sicknesses, or his habits, or his little vanities. This extreme candor was a product of unquenchable curiosity, not exhibitionism. Oldenburg had specifically asked Leeuwenhoek to focus on the secretions of the human body, and Leeuwenhoek duly examined his own semen, among other things. He obtained it not by sinfully defiling himself, he wrote in 1677, but before 6 beats of the pulse had intervened after ejaculation, presumably during intercourse with his very patient wife. He thus became the first person to describe spermatozoa. Leeuwenhoek may have thought that omitting minor details could compromise what he correctly regarded as major scientific observations. He relied on Oldenburg to edit out what seemed irrelevant. But Leeuwenhoek's apparent naivete and ridiculous views also cast a persistent shadow on the remarkable things he discovered. Visiting on behalf of the Royal Society in 1685, a student in nearby Leiden tut-tutted that Leeuwenhoek was quite a stranger to letters, master neither of Latin, French, or English, or any other of the modern tongues besides his own. He was thus prone to very odd accounts of things, nay, sometimes such as are wholly irreconcilable with all truth. Even decades after Leeuwenhoek was firmly established as one of the geniuses of the day, a visitor could still remark, one eyebrow lifted, that he has been accused of seeing more with his imagination than with his magnifying glasses. Leeuwenhoek's foibles did not compromise his science. Despite the imperfections of his language and his lack of scientific education, Dobell wrote, the letters are a model for all other workers. He never confuses his facts with his speculations. When recording facts, he invariably says, I have observed. But when giving his interpretations, he prefaces them with, but I imagine, or I figure to myself. Few scientific workers have had so clear a conception of the boundary between observation and theory, fact and fancy, the concrete and the abstract. This so wonderful a spectacle. Leeuwenhoek was adamant about what he was seeing, while acknowledging that it might seem unbelievable. Informed that people of great knowledge in Paris doubted another of his observations, he replied, I do not mind this at all. What I wrote on this subject is perfectly true. They were welcome to come see for themselves. On October 9th, 1676, Leeuwenhoek sent off his Letter 18, now regarded as the founding document for the science of microbiology. It ran to 17.5 folio pages of tightly written script. The letter represented a year's research into Leeuwenhoek's little animals and contained 145 observations in water from well, river, sea, and rooftop, as well as in water infused with peppercorns, ginger, clove, and nutmeg. The colonial spice trade was everywhere in Leeuwenhoek's research. Letter 18 consisted mainly of things he saw on specific dates, without any unifying narrative thread. I have couched my observations in the form of a journal, Leeuwenhoek explained to a colleague, merely that they be better credited in England and among those disbelievers in Paris. He was emphatic about the care with which he made his observations. Note, he advised the Royal Society, that when I say I have viewed the water, I mean that, in scrutinizing 3 or 4 drops, I may do such a lot of work that it keeps me in a sweat. That care and diligence enabled him to see a host of protozoa and other microorganisms, many of them described accurately enough, despite the lack of proper nomenclature, for modern scientists to recognize them by genus or species. The most momentous of these sightings took place on April 24, 1676. While examining a sample he had prepared earlier that month of water with whole peppercorns mixed in, Leeuwenhoek discerned in it, to his great wonder, an incredible number of very little animals of diverse kinds. 3 of them were of types he had seen before, but the 4th sort of creatures were so small, he thought, 100,000 of them could not equal the dimensions of a grain of coarse sand. Microbiologists now regard this as the first unmistakable description of bacteria, the organisms responsible for so many of our infectious diseases. Leeuwenhoek could scarcely contain his excitement at the sheer number of these organisms. "For me, this was, among all the marvels that I have discovered in nature, the most marvelous of all," he wrote. "And I must say that, for my part, no more pleasant sight has yet met my eye than this of so many thousands of living creatures in one small drop of water, all huddling and moving, but each creature having its own motion." The reaction at the Royal Society was more like consternation. The learned gentlemen there temporized for 5 months. When they finally published Letter 18 in March, they inserted a cautionary note at the idea of hundreds of thousands of organisms in a single drop of water. "This phenomenon and some of the following ones seeming to be very extraordinary, the author hath been desired to acquaint us with his method of observing, that others may confirm such observations as these." For all his candor about his personal life, Leeuwenhoek could be secretive about his methods, but he now followed through on his offer to have other scholars look on as he worked, so they could see what he saw. Their testimonials revealed that Leeuwenhoek studied his water samples in a capillary glass tube the thickness of a horsehair, divided into measured parts. Leeuwenhoek also explained the homely comparisons he used to estimate microbial populations. He started with a drop of water the size of a green pea and the number of millet seeds that would fit in a pea. With a bookkeeper's attention to detail, he worked his way downward from there to smaller and smaller units of measure. He also upped his count for the number of organisms seen in a single drop of water to more than 8 million. Seeking to replicate Leeuwenhoek's work, the Royal Society turned to Robert Hooke, who was already beginning to develop a reputation for quarrelsome rivalries. Called on now to deal with this microscopic newcomer, Hooke sounded like an old gunslinger reluctantly retrieving his weapons. "I put in order," he wrote, "such remainders as I had of my former microscopes, having by reason of a weakness in my sight omitted the use of them for many years." Then he prepared an infusion of peppercorns in water and set to work, certain he would discover things much smaller than such as the aforesaid Mr. Leeuwenhoek had affirmed these creatures to be. At first, he found nothing at all. He gave up for most of a week until, "finding it a warm day, I examined again the said water, and then, much to wonder, I discovered vast multitudes of those exceeding small creatures which Mr. Leeuwenhoek had described." After trying out other microscopes and other lighting arrangements, "I discovered many other sorts very much smaller than those I first saw, and some of these so exceedingly small that millions of millions might be contained in one drop of water. I was very much surprised at this so wonderful a spectacle." He could hardly have imagined that nature could contain so exceedingly minute animal productions. But nature is not to be limited by our narrow apprehensions. Instead of quarreling with Leeuwenhoek, Hooke then became his great advocate. He published A Letter of the Ingenious and Inquisitive Mr. Leeuwenhoek of Delft, together with his own findings. The prospect of those small animals was so pleasing to all who saw them, Hooke wrote to Leeuwenhoek, that King Charles II was desirous to see them and very well pleased with the observation and mentioned your name at the same time. In 1680, a vellum diploma, embossed with the Royal Society's red seal and shipped in a silver box, announced to the shopkeeper from Delft that he was henceforth a fellow of the Royal Society. It was the great honor of Leeuwenhoek's life. He had his portrait painted with the diploma prominently displayed in the foreground, and an envious Dutch colleague sneered that this new great man of the century had inquired, on receiving his fellowship, if he would still be obliged to take a back seat in the presence of a doctor of medicine. But beyond its significance for Antonie van Leeuwenhoek, his discovery of microorganisms meant that thoughtful researchers could begin to explore the link between microorganisms and infectious diseases. Deliverance from epidemic disease was now possible. 2. Deadly preconceptions. It was possible, but it didn't happen. Leeuwenhoek himself came so tantalizingly close to the link between microorganisms and disease that those possessed of modern knowledge at times want to shout, "Wait, Antonie, go back!" One anonymous reader did just that, writing to Philosophical Transactions soon after it published Letter 18, to suggest that Leeuwenhoek's work may prompt us to suspect that our air is also vermiculated, that is, alive with worms, particularly in seasons of general infections of men or animals. Leeuwenhoek hadn't found microorganisms in the air, as the editors noted in an aside to that reader's letter. But he found them in other places that might have suggested their role in disease. In 1681, for instance, he advised the Royal Society with his customary candor that, "I ordinarily have a fairly thick stool in the morning." But a bout of diarrhea had led him to apply his microscope to a sample in which he found animalcules moving very prettily, with bodies a little longer than broad, and bellies flattish and furnished with several legs with which they moved through the clear matter, like a woodlouse running up against a wall. It was a protozoan parasite, now called Giardia, which causes one of the more debilitating forms of diarrhea. Leeuwenhoek recognized that these animalcules did not normally turn up in his stool samples, but it seems not to have occurred to him that they might have been the cause of his discomfort. Likewise, in 1683, Leeuwenhoek applied his microscope to his own dental plaque and sent a letter with such clear illustrations of microorganisms living there that a modern microbiologist could recognize some of the same bacterial species that inhabit our mouths today. Leeuwenhoek also sampled plaque from a man who claimed never to have cleaned his mouth and found the animalcules so excessively numerous that all the water seemed to live. But he made no attempt to connect these bacterial communities with tooth decay or other health problems, except perhaps a stinking mouth. Leeuwenhoek was caught up instead, understandably, in the wonderment that there could be more animals in the unclean matter on the teeth in one's mouth than there are men in a whole kingdom. His genius lay in seeing well and describing what he saw, not in saying what it meant. Humoral thinking. To understand why Leeuwenhoek's discoveries did not immediately revolutionize medical thinking, it's necessary to backtrack a little and understand the world contemporary physicians inhabited. Humoral theory dominated medicine then, and it must have seemed like a beautifully complete paradigm for understanding the human body and its many malfunctions. Health consisted of a balance among four bodily fluids: blood, black bile, yellow bile, and phlegm. Sickness had to do with something in the individual's makeup that threw these fluids out of their natural equilibrium in response to miasmas, noxious air or atmosphere, effluvia, emanations from the decay of bodily matter, telluric forces, movements within the earth, or the alignment of the heavens. Influenza at first meant influenced by the stars, among other factors. Infectious diseases did not exist as we now think of them, caused by distinct pathogens originating outside the human body. Nor was there much medical consideration of diseases being passed contagiously from one person to another. Hippocrates, circa 460 to 370 BC, the father of medicine, had promulgated humoral theory in an effort to shift medical thinking about disease toward natural causes. He meant it as a move away from demonic theory, the tendency to attribute disease to the wrath of the gods. Galen, 129 to 200 AD, a Greek physician in the Roman Empire, expanded on the humoral idea and made it the foundation of Western medicine. Middle Eastern thinkers, notably Persian polymath Avicenna, Ibn Sina, circa 980 to 1037, preserved the idea through the Middle Ages in Europe and also spread it across the Islamic world and east to China. Humoral theory seemed logical. Each of the four humors, blood, black bile, yellow bile, and phlegm, corresponded to one of four temperaments, sanguine, melancholic, choleric, phlegmatic, four seasons, spring, autumn, summer, winter, and the four supposed elements, air, earth, fire, water. It made it possible to link changes in health to weather or season in ways that seemed plausible and at times contained hints of truth. A physician might have attributed the sicknesses of people living in a marshy neighborhood, for instance, to a humoral imbalance brought on by swampy miasmas, while a modern epidemiologist would focus instead on the danger of mosquito-borne diseases. And where a humoral doctor might have attributed a diarrhea outbreak in an urban neighborhood to putrid vapors, the epidemiologist might instead suspect a contaminated water supply. The humoral system also seemed to explain the role of human behaviors in disease. When eating or drinking too much produced a bellyache or throbbing head, for instance, it could seem as if these behaviors had disrupted the humoral equilibrium. Not least, humoral theory seemed believable to patients. It provided highly active measures that physicians and patients necessarily performed together to purge out-of-balance humors. These interventions were supposed to be painful. It was the smart that they produced which drew the humors or cajoled nature into action, medical historian Hannah Newton has written. The humoral physician was no mere servant of nature. He was goading nature into doing what he thought was necessary. Human physiology was arranged conveniently for this purpose. God that made the body of man hath not in vain created so many ways and passages to purge forth the humors, a 16th century Dutch physician exulted. They could be cast out via the nostrils by blowing or bleeding, the palate by sneezing and spitting, the lungs by coughing, the stomach by vomiting, and the skin by sweating, all in addition to the exuberant productions of bowel, bladder, and genitals. First, though, a Scottish physician of the same era wrote, "The body must be prepared, and the humors must be made flexible, to bring the disease to a crisis and allow the humors to flow." Imagery of food preparation and cookery was used in this context, Newton writes. Nature chopped and melted the thick humors so that they could be more easily evacuated. Bloodletting was the most common humoral remedy, a pint at a time, more than a tenth of the total blood supply for an average adult, often repeated at intervals of days or even hours. Practitioners and patients alike appear to have been equally impressed with the results, except presumably in cases of death. Understanding how humoral theory could have dominated medicine for more than 2,000 years is a struggle for modern readers, beginning with the vocabulary, which continues to shape how we speak even now, though in confusing ways. Hippocrates did not, of course, use the word humor. He used hemos, meaning juice or sap. That got translated into humor based on the Latin humor, meaning moisture, as in the word humidity. The language becomes especially tangled because the association between bodily humors and temperaments has stayed with us. Among his more than 100 uses of the word, Shakespeare has both a black oppressing humor, Love's Labor's Lost, and a merry humor, Comedy of Errors. The merrier meaning has prevailed, and a word that started out with bodily fluids now refers to stuff that makes us laugh. But maybe that's not such a stretch after all. Even stranger, the word phlegm, from ancient Greek phlegain, meaning to burn, has evolved into phlegmatic, a word we now use for people who are cold and unemotional. One word, melancholy, comes directly from humoral theory's black bile, Greek melancholia. But that's hardly what we think about when we hear Frank Sinatra singing My Melancholy Baby. Humoral theory, one historian writes, is embedded as a sort of verbal fossil in our language. The real difficulty in understanding the persistence of humoral medicine isn't the language, though. It's the divergence from our idea of reality. Hippocrates, Galen, and all their followers, the French immunologist Charles Richer complained in a 1910 talk, describe humors which they had never seen and which no one will ever see, for they do not exist. The human body contains blood and bile, of course, but the terms black or yellow bile are meaningless for us. And the phlegm of humoral theory was not the stuff we clear from our throats, but some unknown product of the pituitary gland. What can we say, Richer went on, of this fanciful classification of humors into four groups, of which two are absolutely imaginary? One thing we can say is that people are prone to the conventional wisdom of their times. Richer, for example, was a proponent of European racial superiority and a spiritualist who coined the word ectoplasm. A more surprising explanation for the persistence of humoral theory is that physicians did not just imagine the humors they described, but actually saw them in the blood they drew. In the early 1920s, a Swedish pathologist named Robin Foreus helped popularize the erythrocyte sedimentation rate, a test that requires leaving a blood sample to coagulate for an hour in a glass tube. In a healthy patient, the sedimentation rate is slow, and the result is a uniform red. You could say it's balanced. But in certain inflammatory conditions, sedimentation occurs so rapidly that the sample breaks down into four distinct layers. That seemed useful to Foreus for recognizing conditions that produce systemic inflammation, like colitis or rheumatoid arthritis. Beyond that, he saw a correspondence between the layered blood sample and humoral theory. with the bottom layer of densely packed red blood cells corresponding to black bile, the translucent red layer just above that to blood, the thin layer above that to yellow bile, and the white layer on top to what the ancients called phlegm. In blood samples from sick patients, the phlegm, what we now call plasma, can make up more than half the sample. That's why the ancient Greeks believed, Fourierus wrote, that phlegm was, by far, the most important cause of almost all diseases. Fourierus did not cite evidence in humoral writings to back up this theory, but when doctors bled their patients, which they did, alarmingly often, they noted whether the blood was, as one of them put it, well-colored and in such proportion as is usual in healthful persons. Subsequent researchers have, however, generally reverted to the idea that the four humors originated in speculative natural philosophy. Contagion. This brings us back to the question on which hundreds of millions of human lives hung, or rather would be lost. Why didn't Leeuwenhoek's detailed descriptions of protozoa and bacteria, or the work of scientists and physicians before and long after, lead to new insights into contagion, or perhaps even to recognition that pathogens cause disease? The idea that certain diseases, particularly plague and leprosy, could be contagious had ancient roots. Quarantines were a familiar tool in epidemics to keep out people from areas believed to be infected. So was isolation of infected individuals within a community. But these practices existed apart from conventional medicine. For centuries, medical thinkers seem not to have asked just what a quarantine was keeping out, or what mysterious factor was getting through when a seemingly contagious disease began to spread. And when these questions became gradually more common from the mid-17th century on, anti-contagionist thinkers fended them off, often with good reason. Questions and suppositions did not add up to evidence. A contagionism proponent might suspect some seed or other unknown disease factor could pass from a sick person to a new victim by various means. But patients sometimes fell sick when no direct source of contagion was apparent, or they remained inexplicably healthy, even as beloved family members fell sick and died all around them. Epidemics broke out in areas where no sick person was known to have visited, or they sometimes raged through a particular village or neighborhood and then stopped there without spreading to nearby areas. Concepts we now take for granted were entirely unknown then. Physicians didn't realize that some people could be hidden carriers of disease, suffering no symptoms even as they infected those around them. They recognized that people sometimes acquired resistance through prior exposure to certain diseases, but they had no idea at all about the role of genetic variation or inheritance in shaping individual susceptibility to different diseases. They didn't understand that disease could arrive in their drinking water or their food, or be transmitted by animals, including the livestock that shared their land and even their homes. Above all, doctors didn't understand that the tightly interwoven infectious illnesses of humans and other animals were the product of yet other living things, or that these living things, what we call microbes, each had its own peculiar ecology. Unfamiliar diseases and their microbes were, meanwhile, teaching terrifying new lessons about the deadly price of ignorance almost everywhere. 3. Foreign bodies. Two related events in the era before Leeuwenhoek might have led to new ways of thinking about the nature of contagion. The first began almost the moment European explorers stepped ashore in the New World in 1492. Native Americans were soon slipping away before an invading army of unfamiliar infectious diseases, from measles to smallpox. Just in the first century of colonization, according to one recent estimate, these diseases took the lives of 56 million people. The modern understanding is that New World people and their immune systems had been separated from Old World diseases since the collapse of the land bridge across the Bering Strait more than 10,000 years earlier. Thus, they had no acquired immunity to infectious diseases that had meantime become common, particularly the zoonotic diseases routinely encountered by Old World people in their close dealings with domesticated livestock herds. The newcomers also tended to arrive from crowded Old World communities where they and their forebears had survived a long list of infectious diseases with population-wide effects on immune resistance. So smallpox, for instance, might kill between 15 and 30% of European victims, but 90% of some Native American tribes. European colonizers didn't understand at first that they were giving diseases to the people they encountered. But they rejoiced once they recognized that the great dying was underway. King James I of England celebrated the utter destruction, devastation, and depopulation of that whole territory after a mysterious plague annihilated Native American populations in Massachusetts in about 1617. This was in the official charter of New England, sending the Puritans off in the Mayflower. God had brought Europeans to a country wonderfully prepared for their entertainment by a prodigious pestilence, Puritan minister Cotton Mather, 1663 to 1728, explained in a 1702 history of the settlement, so that the woods were almost cleared of those pernicious creatures to make room for a better growth. This pestilence not only killed vast multitudes, but also conveniently left those tawny pagans who survived smitten into awful and humble regards of the English. The colonists exploited their sense of physiological, social, and moral superiority to justify the taking of land, and even souls, by a kind of religious eminent domain. An early missionary who proselytized among American tribes won praise in a contemporary Jesuit history for exerting the greatest care to let no infant miss baptism. That way, when smallpox opportunely intervened, he gathered in a rich harvest of these innocent souls. The sense of European superiority, together with a strong dose of humoralism, led to a theory of American degeneracy, proposed by an 18th-century French naturalist. Humans and animals in these melancholy regions were supposedly weaker because of the hostile climate and the dense forests, overloaded with humid and noxious vapors. A most presumptuous pox. The grand experiment that was killing tens of millions of people across the Americas made almost no difference, however, to people trying to understand the nature of infectious diseases. Medical thinkers focused instead on a disease much closer to the heart of European life. Physicians at first cared not even to behold this new disease, much less to touch the infected, Ulrich von Hutten wrote in his De Morbo Gallico, The French Disease, published in 1519. It was unlike anything they had ever encountered. The earliest victims had boils that stood out like acorns, from whence issued such filthy, stinking matter, he wrote, that whosoever came within the scent believed himself infected. The very aspect was as shocking as the pain itself, which yet was as if the sick had lain upon a fire. Patients in the first wave of the outbreak suffered pustules on the skin, which mutate into ulcers and spread to the nervous parts and attack the bones, Italian physician Girolamo Francastoro, 1478-1553, reported. Some victims suffered the complete destruction of the lips, others of the nose, and others of all their genitals. Death was quick and agonizing at first, but within a few decades the disease shifted form, and the agony, though less obvious, was drawn out over years or even decades. It had no name at first, except for a sort of geographical finger pointing. To the Russians, it was the Polish disease, and the Poles deemed it a product of Germany. In India, where colonizers carried it in 1498, it became the Portuguese evil. And in Japan, in 1515, it was the Chinese ulcer. In truth, no one knew where it came from, but it traveled faster than any disease before it by way of colonization and commerce. Francastoro later gave the disease a lasting name, minus the geographical slurs. Sometime between 1510 and 1530, he turned the pandemic into the unlikely subject of an epic poem. It featured a shepherd tending the many flocks of his king. In despair, when a summer drought begins killing his sheep, the shepherd blasphemes the god in charge of such phenomena. The god then curses shepherd, king, and nation with a hideous leprosy, on which he also bestows the shepherd's name, syphilis. It would in time displace the uglier common name, the pox. The European outbreak probably began with the first voyage of Christopher Columbus to the New World. On returning to Spain in 1493, Columbus went to Barcelona with some of his crew and captives, women taken as sex slaves, to report to his royal sponsors, King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella. There, a physician wrote that he treated members of the expedition for a disease never seen or recognized or found in medical books. From Barcelona, syphilis skipped across the Mediterranean to Italy, probably by way of sailors, mercenaries, or prostitutes attached to the army sent out to defend Ferdinand and Isabella's hereditary claim to Naples. In 1495, all the elements of a super-spreading event momentarily came together when an invading French army marched into Naples unopposed. They seem to have remained only long enough for soldiers to consort with prostitutes and to court or rape local women. When the French king subsequently disbanded his troops, they scattered back to every corner of Europe, bearing to their wives and lovers the gift of the spiral-shaped bacteria known today as Treponema pallidum. The long, injurious season. The willingness of many victims to describe their experiences with syphilis in print represented a dramatic change in medicine. The advent of syphilis marks the beginning of a new approach to disease itself, leading physicians out of their traditional dependence upon medieval and classical texts, according to historian Bruce Thomas Borer, and instead forcing them to interact with each other and with their patients and patrons to an unprecedented degree. Publishing was a key element in this transformation. Commercial printing had become commonplace since Johannes Gutenberg's invention of the movable type printing press a half century earlier. By one count, a dozen medical tracts about the new disease appeared just between 1497 and 1501, including some of the first narratives of a disease written by the patient. People may have been willing to discuss their symptoms frankly because syphilis was still a mysterious calamity afflicting much of the adult population. Victims did not at first understand that they were dealing with a sexually transmitted disease, given how little anyone understood about the causes of any medical condition, and also given the dormancy period of as much as 6 weeks between infection and the onset of symptoms. The search for remedies was the driving topic. Surgeons, sensing a business opportunity, applied hot irons to the scourge of swellings, knobs, and sores. This unthinkable cruelty proving useless, they moved on to ointments made of bayberry, burnt salt, turpentine, and almost anything else they could lay their hands on. Mercury became the dominant syphilis treatment in about 1500, as an ointment to be slathered onto the skin, an elixir to be drunk, or fumes to be inhaled. Some patients submitted 3 or 4 times a day to treatment in a heated chamber, with a pan over a fire releasing mercury and other substances into the air. Symptoms of syphilis and mercury poisoning overlapped and became confused. Hutton and his contemporaries took the excess flow of saliva produced by mercury for a draining out of corrupted humors. When sores afflicted the mouth, throat, and lungs, he wrote, "A stinking matter continually was voided from these places, which sort of cure was indeed so terrible that many chose rather to die than to be eased thus of their sickness." The treatment itself could be fatal. In a single day, one practitioner killed 3 patients through such excessive heat their hearts failed them. Hutton, infected in the second wave of syphilis, submitted repeatedly to this treatment while still in his 20s. His physicians sweated and bled him. They fed him an assortment of elixirs, but no remedy brought lasting relief, and he wrote that a close friend, "seeing me so bitterly vexed with pain that I could neither rest by night nor take my food by day, advised me to kill myself." Some fellow sufferers ran like madmen, not only their hands and feet, but their whole bodies trembling. Some also were forced to mumble and stammer in their speech as long as they lived, without any remedy. Some victims of the disease or its remedies hanged themselves or slit their own throats. Little steamy bodies. The idea that a disease could be something carried in the bodies of people aboard ships or on horseback, and thus spread from one end of the earth to the other, was only dimly beginning to take shape. In the first printed medical book in English, 1547's Breviary of Health, the author, a physician, warned that the disease could be acquired from lying in bedsheets or sitting on a toilet or saddle lately used by a pocky person, but specially it is taken when a pocky person doth sin in lechery the one with another. Hutton acknowledged that syphilis rarely occurred in those not given to fornication or bodily lust, and that the more a man is addicted to these pleasures, the sooner he catcheth it. But he preferred to attribute his own disease to the dire circumstances of his life as a wandering writer. One practical remedy that soon appeared was an early version of the condom, introduced by a Catholic priest named Gabriella Fallopio, 1523 to 1562. Having taken his vows primarily for financial support, he went on to become a brilliant anatomist at the University of Padua. He was the first person to describe numerous anatomical features, including the tubes leading from the ovaries to the uterus, which now bear his name. He also introduced the term vagina, and was one of the first medical authorities to describe the function of the clitoris. The condom he devised was, however, meant solely to protect the male. Out of concern for the frame of mind of the prostitutes, he wrote, one could hardly show up for an assignation carrying prophylactic ointments. Instead, he recommended carefully cleaning the penis after sex and then placing it in the linen sheath he had invented, soaked with medications and tied up with a ribbon for a period of recovery. The cavalier attitude to the fate of women was characteristic of the time. Hutton, for instance, advised men recovering from the new disease to abstain from the fleshly act, mainly to avoid aggravating their own sickness, not out of concern that they might infect their partners. Eustachio Rudio, a medical professor at Padua, put it more plainly, "Paid women are worth preserving not for their own health, but primarily for the sake of their male customers." When a British physician advanced a vaguely animalcular explanation of syphilis in 1670, women were still of interest only as a cause of disease, not as victims in need of treatment. He thought syphilis had arisen in the heat of intercourse between a diseased Frenchman and a fretted Neapolitan whore, creating little steamy bodies or atoms. These proliferated in her body, as only living things could do, to infect other men who slept with her. Taking the wood. Hope came finally from a shade tree. Sometime between 1506 and 1516, wood from the guaiacum tree began to be imported into Europe from the Caribbean. There, Hutton wrote, all the inhabitants are, at some times, diseased with this sickness, as we are with the measles and smallpox, nor have they any surer remedy, therefore, than this. In Hutton's minutely detailed recipe, 1 pound of wood chips or sawdust slowly simmered in 8 pounds of water yielded a faintly muddy, sour-tasting liquid to be chugged down twice a day, and a powder to be applied to the sores. The treatment regimen entailed sitting under a heap of blankets in a heated room while being slowly starved and purged. The patient consumed about a quarter pound of guaiacum a day for 30 days on a diet otherwise sufficient only to keep off fainting. The principal and chief effect of this wood, Hutton promised his readers and himself, is to heal the French pox, which it does effectually eradicate, even though of long standing. He offered caveats. The treatment worked only gradually to cleanse and purify the corrupted blood and to expel the hurtful humors nourishing the distemper. It could also be painful. In some patients, it maketh the bones bare, in some the sinews and veins, in the course of searching and destroying the putrid flesh infected with the sickness. But he added, as if preaching a sermon, it then, I say, healeth up the same. Readers looked up from their despair and sang Alleluia, or at least the ones who could afford guaiacum did. Soon Hutton's book had a popularity and distribution such as had few medical works of any period. physician Robert S. Munger wrote in a 1949 history of Guaiacum, reprinted, paraphrased, and translated into several languages, it quickly became established as the guide to the treatment of syphilis. Demand for Guaiacum soared, and so did the price. Being freed from mercury poisoning might have been enough to make Guaiacum feel like a miraculous cure, for a little while. It also allowed the patient's disease a chance to abate on its own, a characteristic of syphilis not then understood, Munger wrote. Wishful patients mistook the temporary relief for an effect of the treatment, and when some patients showed no benefit from the supposed panacea, then the patient was to blame, not the medicine. Guaiacum would remain popular until the 20th century, when science finally demonstrated that it was completely useless against syphilis. Hutton was among the many syphilitics who found this out on their own. In a July 1523 letter to a friend, he wondered if the unhappy fate that pursues us so bitterly would ever be checked. A few weeks later, at the end of summer, he died, age 34. Syphilis had driven home the frightening reality of contagion. But the answer to one key question was still missing. Contagion how? Learned men would go on seeking the answer in the corruption of the air, in decomposing organic matter, in the weather, and in the stars. But a few early medical thinkers began to speculate about the actual mechanism by which sickness might pass from one person to another. 4. Precursors. In his 1546 tract, Contagion, Contagious Diseases and Their Treatment, Girolamo Francastoro largely set aside the idea that diseases arose from miasmas or from some predisposing humoral imbalance in the victim. Instead, he argued that seminaria, that is, germs or seeds, were to blame, and that a given germ was specific to a particular disease, causing a certain precisely similar corruption in anyone those germs infected. Moreover, germs could generate and propagate other germs precisely like themselves, and these in turn...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.